dawn of creation. This world has been crying out for hope, for a hero to save us. We long for the supernatural.
But there is only one God who can save the day. So clear the stage, prepare the way, 'cause heaven and earth are singing.
Glory, hallelujah, let the whole world sing. The greatness of our God, in awesome wonder, He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. The greatness of our God.
There's no one above Him. Only our Savior wears the crown. There's none who can stop Him. Not even the grave could hold Him down.
There is only one King who can save the day. So clear the stage, prepare the way, 'cause heaven and earth are singing.
Glory, hallelujah, let the whole world sing. The greatness of our God, in awesome wonder, He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God.
Guys, you can be seated.
Well, good morning, church. It is a great day to worship in the house of the Lord today. If you're new here, we would love to learn more about you. So if you could just fill out a Connect card. It's located in the seat pocket in front of you. And if you could just drop it in the basket in the back, that'd be awesome. Or if you're new and worshiping with us online, you can go ahead and click the New Here button. As you can see, we're still in the midst of our renovations, and in fact, I was told that our new baptistry is being delivered tomorrow. Yes, praise the Lord. Something we'd like to do today as a church family is at the end of the worship service, Joe is going to invite us all to write scriptures and prayers on this stage as a way of showing our intentions to build upon Jesus. And I really hope everybody will participate. I'd love to see lots of prayers and verses up here. If you'd like to worship through giving, you can do that by dropping your offering in the plate at the back or online at smithfieldchristian.com or by texting the number on the screen. Today, Joe is going to be talking about some of the things that can wreck our relationships, specifically family relationships. So let's keep an open heart and an open mind and see what God has in store for us. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for another day and another opportunity to gather as your church and worship you. Lord, I want to lift up this service to you. Please open our hearts to what you'd have us to hear today. Let it transform us. Help us not just be hearers of the word, but doers also. Help us to be your hands and feet in this community. In your name we pray. Amen.
We stand and continue our worship service. One, two, oh, 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 oh. Hello, my name is Regret. I'm pretty sure we have met. Every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again till you lost all belief. Oh, these are the voices, and these are the lies, and I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. Let me hear it. I am no longer defined by all the wreckage behind. The one who makes all things new has proven it's true. Let's take a look at my life. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
What love the Father's lavished, right?
What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called his children. I am a child of the One True King. What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called his children. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. But oh, oh, oh. But oh, oh, oh. But oh, oh, oh. I am a child of the One True King.
Thank you. God our Savior, God our matchless King, God your glory never falls away. Your mercy forever, your mercy for all. Oh Lord my God, when in awesome wonder sing my soul your song again. Oh Lord my God, when I'm lost in wonder sing my soul how great thou art. Maker, God of everything, your justice forever, your justice, amen. Guys, for singing, man.
I hear and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Guys, thank you so much for singing with us this morning. You can be seated.
So if you're new here, we do communion weekly, which is probably one of my favorite parts of this church. Being able to remember the sacrifice Jesus made and kind of do so as a church family together. If you're worshiping online with us, we do have communion supplies available here at the church you can pick up during the week. For those of you who are here, they are in front of you in the seat pockets. So feel free to partake as you feel comfortable after my devotion here. So this week we're talking about homewreckers and homemakers, and more specifically today about homewreckers. So thanks, Joe, for saying Troy would be the appropriate one to talk during this time, I guess. So, you know, unfortunately, I do come from a broken home, and as tough as that is, what was harder is the fact that at one point in my life, I created a broken home. And, you know, in 2011, when me and Braden's mom separated, like, the only thing I could think is I was that homewrecker, right? Like, what did I do wrong to the marriage, to the family? You know, what was it about me that could have been different, that could have been better? The truth is, it wasn't me. It was the devil, right? When you think about folks coming in and wrecking homes, you think about, oh, whose fault was it? Who was it that's the homewrecker? And I know it was the devil, but man, God works in mysterious ways, because there I was in 2011, a single father, not going to church, kind of forgetting that Jesus was here and he died for me. And it wasn't an easy road. It wasn't a quick road, but God left those 99 to come find me, the one. And, you know, as we sign the stage today, I kind of got prime front and center myself. And if you know me, you know what it says, right? While we were still sinners. There I was, that homewrecker, that sinner. And there God was, not giving up on. And truth be told, probably the best thing that could have happened for me was that part of my life. I changed jobs, I changed careers, I transitioned out of the Navy. I spent 4 years, and now I've got a perfect home. Maybe Joe, I can come talk about being a homemaker next week, or Sarah, you should probably be the one to talk about making the home. But don't forget, when you're at your lowest of low and you're asking yourself, God, why me? That might have been the devil, but God isn't giving up on you. So when we take communion today, man, God came to this earth to live like us, to die for us, so that a sinner like me can find him again and enjoy an everlasting life in his throne room. Let us pray. God, the path you create for us isn't always easy. It isn't always fun. But regardless of the mistakes we've made, regardless of how hard the devil has worked in our life, regardless of how much we've thought about giving up, you don't give up on us. You are always looking at that opportunity to open that door and bring us back to you and your grace and your love. Thanks for sending your son to die for us. Thanks for the cross. Thanks for eternal life. And thanks for allowing us to spend this time with your body and your blood, remembering that the sacrifice you made was for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
So much to do.
A few prayer requests that I wanted to share that were in the basket this morning. Excuse me. This one, it says, please pray for safety for Pat Owens. This is the brother of Don Owens, who is hiking the Appalachian Trail until May 16th. And Don just got back from doing some of that with him. Is that right? So, yeah, so definitely be praying for Pat and for his safety. just got word this morning that Martha Scarborough was taken to the ER at OBC with high blood pressure. So we'll kind of keep you all updated about that as we hear, and definitely be praying for her. This one, Jackie Van Buren's neighbor, Maria, says that she saw a fatal car accident on Highway 10 this past week. So we want to be praying for Maria, for some peace for her, but also be praying for the truck driver that was involved with that. And then one other, Jackie also puts on here a quote that's really great. This is from Dennis Grannon. It says, I know God did not save my life to leave me crippled and in pain. And so she shares just a praise that Tyler Van Buren is on the mend after his surgery. So that's a really great thing to be praising God for. You see, we have still have our fire and our tent up here, and for a couple reasons. One, we do have our camp scholarship program going on. If you have kids that would be interested in going to camp this summer and want to do the camp scholarship, there's information at the info station in the back. Or if you'd like to donate to the camp scholarship program to help send some kids, then you can put a donation in one of the offering envelopes in the seat pockets in front of you and just mark it for Camp Rudolph, a note on the front there so we know it's, you can make it out to the church, but mark it for Camp Rudolph so we know it's about it. Or even online, you can do that on the list of funds, you can do a Camp Rudolph. But we want to be praying for Camp Rudolph, too. They're gearing up for their summer. That's going to be very different than any summer they've ever had, with different restrictions and things like that that they have to abide by. So we want to be praying for Camp Rudolph, for Charlie Stevenson, the camp manager, and also just all his workers out there. So let's go to the Lord in prayer for these. God, we just pause here in the midst of this service, and we come to you knowing that you are a God that hears us. You are a father that is concerned about the things that concern us. And Lord, we're grateful that you hear us. We're grateful that you give us that opportunity to come to you, to come to your feet, to come to your throne, to come to your presence and just be with you. God, I do share or lift up to you these different concerns and these needs that we've mentioned this morning. And God, I just pray that you'd be very present in these folks' lives and that you would help them, bring them some comfort and peace and direction and just watch over them, God. Lord, we also pray for Camp Rudolph as they're gearing up for this coming season. I know personally the impact that church camp has on a life and especially a young life. And so, Lord, we just pray. We pray in advance for the great camp season that you're going to bring about and the great lives that you're going to touch and move in a great way. But we also pray for some help and encouragement for the camp staff as they lead up to this summer and as they gear up for that. God, I pray that you would just guide us as we get into your word this morning and study, and may you bring to our eyes and our minds and our ears what your word has to say for each of us, and that we may then put it into our life. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Was a one-season series TV show called WandaVision. Now, if you are a superhero fan, if you're a Marvel superhero fan, you know all about this show, and you're probably nuts about it, and you probably even giggled a little bit when I said the name. If you're not a superhero fan, you probably could not care less about it, okay? Let's just all establish that right now. The plot of WandaVision really is not important. It follows two superheroes that that become a couple, Wanda and Vision, and hence the name of the show, WandaVision. And it's followed their family. But the thing that was kind of interesting and kind of, I think, kind of almost applies into today's message was the way that each week, when there was a new episode that came out, each week the motif, I guess you could say, of the episode followed a different decade. And it started in the 1950s with the very first episode. It had a look to it of the 1950s sitcoms, family sitcoms. And then the second week, it was the 1960s. And then the third week, it was the 1970s. And every week, it kind of went up a decade and on and on. And it was kind of interesting to watch each week when it would kind of change up. You know, it started off looking kind of like Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver, and then on to Bewitched, and all the way up to even some more modern ones, even like Roseanne and Malcolm in the Middle. And it was just kind of interesting to see the differences and think through the differences of the family sitcom and how it has changed and adapted over time. I mean, everything from, you may remember of when the couples slept in the twin beds next to each other in the bedrooms, all the way to what's the family sitcoms are today. They have they've changed a lot. And it's even kind of shown a bit of kind of our culture and how our culture has changed when it comes to family. Well, today and next week, we're going to be looking at the family. There's a lot of different facets, a lot of different parts of the family that we could study. But what we're going to look at is what I believe to be what makes a strong, God-honoring, healthy family. We're going to look at this foundation that we need to have as families. And we're going to see this through this series of home wreckers and home makers. And while the focus of this series isn't so much on this, I think it's probably an appropriate time and an important time for me to just briefly make a comment about our church's understanding of the family. You know, everything that we try and do here is to build everything, every program, every lesson, everything we do upon God's word. We never want to be people that just kind of come up with ideas and things on our own. We want to be people of the Bible. And Smithfield Christian Church's understanding of the family and the makeup of the family is rooted in the Bible. We believe that as God designed it, it is to be a marriage of one man and one woman. And now look, families have different characteristics and different qualities, but God's word tells us that his design for the family was to be this way. In fact, we see kind of the basis for it in Genesis chapter 2. In verse 22, it says, "Then the Lord made man from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, 'This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, and for she was taken out of man.' That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh." Now, this doesn't mean that God doesn't have love for people who are involved in relationships that are outside of his model and his intentions for a family. Those who maybe are cohabitating, those who maybe are living outside of marriage together, those who are involved in same-sex relationships. God loves all people, even when we step outside of his design for marriage, and really for life in general. God loves all people. And in this short series, what I want us to do is look at God's design for the foundation of the family. Now, if you are here today and you're single for whatever reason, if you've never been married, or if you are widowed, or if you're divorced, or maybe you have kids living at home, maybe you don't have kids living at home, maybe you have no kids at all, I hope you understand that this is still a series of things we're going to look at today and even next week that are very applicable for your life. The principles that we're going to look at today, even though we're kind of aiming them at the family unit, they're really the truths of all relationships. And so I don't want you to tune out. I don't want you to think, well, you know, that's not me, so I'm not going to listen to this. Or if you're worshiping online, I don't want you to click away to somewhere else. I believe that God's truth is truth for all of us at all times. And even in this, as we focus on the family, I believe that we can even find some things that are true for all relationships. But today, we're going to kind of start with, I guess you could say, the bad news. We're going to talk about the home wreckers. And no, don't worry, I'm not going to have you line up. I did not ask Troy to, you know, share that very, really moving testimony today. I didn't ask him that, so don't worry. We're not going to line up and everybody share their stories in that way. But instead, we're going to look at some examples in the Bible of those who kind of got it wrong, I guess you could say. Those who could be labeled as wrecked families, wrecked homes. These families that maybe had the wrong priorities, had the wrong mindsets, and because of that, led them down a path of their family, of their home being wrecked. But we're going to look at this with the hope of kind of setting up next week's message, where we can see the other side of things and see how we can be home makers, of how we can be family makers. But before we look at these families, I want you to understand something that's really kind of important and I think also interesting about the fact that the Bible even has families like this that we would consider to be home wreckers. The very fact that there are real families with real issues and real problems, this should be reassuring to us as Christians. And for one thing, in many ways, it's almost kind of a support for the validity of the Bible. I mean, if we were going to make up this story, we probably would have just like made it all perfect and wonderful and, you know, clouds and happiness and sunshine all the time. But that's not real life. And that's not the real people we see in the pages of the Bible. But also, it should remind us that God uses all of us, even to the point of what Troy shared earlier, that God has a path for each one of us. Even when sometimes we stray off those paths, even when sometimes when it doesn't work, we don't work out those paths and those directions quite like God had called us to. God can use each and every one of us. And so this morning, we're going to look at some families that were wrecked, but still were used by God. And we're going to look at the very first family, and that would be the family of Adam and Eve, but more specifically, their sons, Cain and Abel. Now, we don't know a lot about Cain and Abel. We don't know how far apart they were born, their age. You know, we don't really know all the details and the specifics about it. And truthfully, none of those things really, I think, are really all that important. I think what we're going to see instead is more of the story, the arc of their lives and what we gain from that. So we pick it up in Genesis chapter 4 in verse 2. It says, "Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain, his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, 'Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it.' Now Cain said to his brother Abel, 'Let's go to the field.' While they were there in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him." I think it's interesting that this family, because of how these siblings were, I think it's interesting that we can look at them, and in many ways, they're a lot like a lot of sibling relationships. Even though these two boys were raised by the same parents, perhaps probably in the same manner and the same way, they turned out very different. And that's kind of how it is in my family. Thankfully, my brother did not kill me. There are probably many times that he wanted to kill me, my older brother. But a lot of times it's amazing how families can raise their kids in the exact same way, and they just have different personalities and different interests, and just there are different people. And here we see the same thing with Cain and Abel. We see that Cain is sort of the horticulturist of the family. He works the soil. He's got the green thumb. Abel is the one who is working with the flocks, and he worked with the animals. And even when they worshiped God, they had different manners of worshiping God. Their personal interests and their talents kind of spilled into the way that they worshiped God. Cain, he brought the fruits of the soil, and Abel brought some animals. But it said that God looked favorably on Abel's sacrifice, but not Cain's. And we can speculate about why this is. We don't know specifically why it is, and a lot of people have tried to come up with different reasons of why it is. Maybe it had to do with the fact that it said that Abel brought the firstborn. Maybe Cain didn't bring of the first fruits of the fields. Perhaps they knew the kind of sacrifices they were supposed to have been brought. I mean, the truth is, there were a lot of things that went on and probably conversations that they had with their parents and with God that we don't know about, and perhaps they knew the kind of sacrifices they were supposed to bring. But no matter what it is, God looked favorably on Abel's sacrifice. But even though he looked favorably on Abel's and not on Cain's, we see no indication that God punished Cain or even rebuked him for the sacrifice he brought. But Cain's sacrifice wasn't honored or recognized in the same way that his brother's was. And so he became jealous, and it drove him to kill his brother. You see, the homewrecker in this situation is jealousy. We could even go so far as to say that it perhaps was even spiritual jealousy. But it was the jealousy that drove Cain to hate his brother in such a way to kill him. And again, we have no indication that God was punishing Cain or making things bad for Cain or anything like that. It just simply said that Abel was receiving this recognition, this praise, and this favor from God. And sadly, there are times in life where family members can look at one another and see things and how God may be blessing or how things may be going well in their family, and maybe whether or not they are God's direct blessing or not, they may be perceived as God's favor of them. And instead of being excited for our family members and encouraging them with those things, we can become jealous and we can become bitter, even to the extent of trying to tear down a sibling or even another person when we see God's blessing in their life. And we can even sometimes try and put the attention on ourselves to try and build ourselves up even more to see like we're even better or greater or more favored by God or whatever. But that never works out the way we think it will whenever we do that. In fact, Paul says this in Galatians 5:15. He says, if you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. Paul is trying to tell his readers, and he's trying to tell us, if we can't learn to get along and be encouraging, it will only end in our demise. No good will come from it. I mean, think about it. When you're in those situations, and then there's that person in your family, maybe in your extended family, or even your immediate family, or maybe it's a close friend or whatever, and something great happens in their life, some kind of blessing comes along, do you show up and encourage them? Or do you find yourself kind of more of being negative and being critical of their situation? Well, why do they have to talk about that? Why do they have to bring that? I can't believe they're, whatever it might be. And do you even maybe build yourself up? Well, you know, I also, and you have to sort of one-up them with it. You see, when that happens, though, people can see right through that, and it doesn't bring about the joy. It doesn't really make people look on you more favorably. It kind of reminds me of the situation we studied a few months back of Jesus' parable of the prodigal son, we call it, of the son who went off, took his inheritance, took all the stuff that he got from his father, went off and squandered it, spent it in wild living, and he comes back and he's ready to kind of beg for forgiveness and beg for help, and instead the father just accepts him back like nothing happened, and it gets excited that his son will be back. But you remember what happened with the older brother. The older brother doesn't react quite so happy about it. We can find it in Luke 15 and verse 25. It says, meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him, what was going on? Your brother has come home, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. Do you hear how that sounds? I mean, the father even goes on and he pleads with him to come in. Please come and celebrate this great blessing of your brother with us. But he doesn't do it. When someone in your family, you know, when they have something great happening, are you celebrating with them or are you looking for ways to tear it down? Do you celebrate their new job, their new home, their new family, their new diploma? Do you celebrate with them or do you tear them down? Friends, we need to celebrate these things. And when we do that, I really believe that if we celebrate the other people in our family, I believe that we'll have it reciprocated back to us. They'll want to celebrate the things in our life too. The second wrecked family, I guess you could say, would be that we're going to look at today is Joseph and his brothers. Joseph and his brothers. Now Joseph, I think he kind of had the opposite situation, the opposite wrecked home from Cain and Abel. Joseph, he had 11 brothers. Man, good night. I can't imagine. 11 boys in the house growing up there. That would be something else. But it came to a point in our life where it seemed it was very obvious that Joseph was a very blessed young man. We can pick up in Genesis 37 and verse 2. It says, this is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the son of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. So Joseph goes and tattles on his brothers. Now Israel, this is another name for Jacob, now Israel loved Joseph more than all of his other sons because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. So Joseph goes and he rats out his brothers, and in the midst of all these different things happening, his father just loves him so much, is just so enamored with him because he was blessed with him in his old age, and he gives him this special gift. And so it's very obvious to everybody, because Joseph's wearing this bright colored robe, it's very obvious to everybody that his dad loves him in a special way. But then we go on to verse 4. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream. And this time the sun and the moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he had told his father and all as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. You may know what happens next after this. Joseph one day is sent out by his father to his brothers to check on them, take some supplies. They see the dreamer, they call. Here comes that dreamer, and they decide that they're going to do something about it. And they end up throwing him in a pit, selling him off to slave traders. And then they take his robe back home and they tell their father, "Oh, your son was killed by wild animals." And all this happened because of their jealousy. And while jealousy was really the root of what happened within Cain and Abel's situation, I think the difference here is that Joseph is provoking all of this. If Cain's issue was jealousy, then Joseph's issue was pride. Look, you know your dad loves you. You know he favors you. You know he loves you, unfortunately, more than your other brothers. So why do you egg it on? You know that you're having these dreams and these visions where it seems as God is favoring you as well as your father. You don't need to brag about it to your family. You see, the issue of Joseph's, it even kind of rears its ugly head later on. If you go to the very end of the book of Genesis, when a great famine hits the land, Joseph has, because of God's blessing, is now second in command to Pharaoh. Pharaoh puts him in charge of gathering food to be able to care for the world, the known world at that time for them, and to be able to provide food for them. And the famine reached Joseph's family, and they have to come to Egypt and ask for food, and they don't realize that they're asking Joseph, their brother, his son, for this food. And he kind of begins to toy with them, maybe a little bit of that bragging of, "Look, the position that I'm in," he begins to brag in, but thankfully he wises up to it. And we find in Genesis 50 in verse 19, "But Joseph said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives.'" And then his family is brought to Egypt to live with them, and they share in the blessings. But what about us? Do we do this too? Man, it can be really easy to brag, to flaunt, to talk ourselves up. It's really easy to make it about what God's doing for me. And we can kind of fall into this trap that Paul warns us about in Philippians 2. He says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others." Again, it's the opposite of Cain and Abel's situation. You know, here Joseph is looking for every opportunity to bolster his own position and elevate himself above his brothers and to brag and to talk about how great his situation is. Instead, he should have done what Paul goes on to say now in verse 5 there in Philippians. "In your relationship, in relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Man, that phrase there, that Jesus did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. I mean, I think most people would read that and be like, why not? Why would you not use that, Jesus? You're God. I mean, good grief, use that to your own advantage. Why in the world would God step out of his position, come in the flesh, and serve us, serve as a servant? Because when we are able, when we take on this role of a servant, I believe that the reason he displays this for all of us, I believe the reason that he steps into this mode and does this and tries to help us understand that we should do this, is that when you and I, when we take on the role of a servant and we serve each other, instead of building ourselves up in pride, when we serve, we all win. When we are all serving each other, we all win. So often we think that the best way to win is to push ourselves up by pushing off of people and pushing them down as I'm pushing myself up. You know, when we can finally overpower, outwork, outbuy, out-earn, do whatever, you know, just to get more and more and have more than everyone else, then we finally win. But it's not about that at all. What we see throughout all the pages of Scripture, the way that we win in Christ Jesus is we win through humility. That should be what our goal is. Not to build ourselves up, but to push others ahead. You know, there is a lot of turmoil and strife going on lately, politically, racially, even economically. And I know that this sermon is focused on families, but I cannot help but think what our world would be like if we would all serve each other, if we would all love in this same manner, if we would all stop trying to be the loudest and the strongest and the most powerful and the smartest and the wealthiest and whatever, and just looked for ways to help and to serve and to love. And I think sometimes we even hear a message like that and we begin to think of, yeah, if those people would just humble themselves and if they would just, no. It's not about what they, it's about what I, of humbling myself and stepping away from my pride. There are a lot of, you know, people that we could look at throughout the Scriptures, a lot of families that are wrecked. I was talking with Beth about this message, and I said, you know, I think in some ways, the easier list of families from the Bible would be the families that were not wrecked. Because unfortunately, there are very few families in the Scriptures that you could look at and say, yeah, they got it all right. But there's one other family that I want us to look at before we wrap up, and that is of Samson and Delilah. Now, Samson was a unique guy. He had a unique strength. He was blessed by God because of a vow he took. His parents brought him into this vow of a Nazarite. Now, a Nazarite was basically someone who was committed all their life that they would never touch a dead body, they would never touch any type of fermented drink, and they would never cut their hair. And because of that, God blessed him with strength, and he used that strength that he gave Samson to beat and humiliate the Philistines several times. And because of that, the Philistines hated Samson. And so they convinced Delilah to get his secret. Now, look, we don't know for sure the relationship, really, the specifics of between him and Delilah. We don't know if they were married. Most likely they were not married. Otherwise, she would probably have been referred to as his wife. But she was definitely in the role of a significant other or of a spouse in a way. And so the Philistines come to Delilah, and they convince her to go and get Samson's secret. And if you know the situation of what happens with Samson, he doesn't really give in right away. She asks him for the secret, and he says, well, if you tie me up with fresh bowstrings, then, you know, I'm worthless. And they do it, but he breaks free, and he conquers over them. And then she comes back and says, oh, you know, you've humiliated me. Tell me the secret. And so he says, all right, well, if you do new ropes. And well, that happens again where he breaks free and humiliates them. And she comes back and begs again. And he says, no, actually, if you weave my hair, my long hair, into a loom, well, I'm worthless. I'm not. I mean, it happens over and over like this. And finally, we find in Judges 16:16, it says, with such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was sick to death of it. So he told her everything. He said, no razor has ever been used on my head, he said, because I am a Nazarite dedicated to God from my mother's womb. If my head were shaved, my strength would leave me, and I would become as weak as any other man. And well, that night, they come in, the Philistines come in, and they cut his hair, and they overpower him, and they capture him, and they carry him off as a prisoner. And we could come up with all different reasons why this happened to Samson, but I think the one that I want to focus on right here is what I'm going to call simply idolatry. Now, idolatry is defined as the extreme admiration, love, or reverence for something or someone. I believe that we would call it idolatry here because Samson was putting Delilah, his spouse, if you will, in the place of God and making her wishes and making the things that she wanted more important than God's calling and his commitment to God. But not only that, I don't think it was just the idolatry of with his wife or with Delilah. I think it was also the idolatry of self for him. To arrogantly put himself in God's place and to feel like I can handle myself, you know, I'm good, you know, I may lose my strength, but I can handle myself with these Philistines. And I see this happen in relationships all the time. A spouse feels this burden or this need to put their wife or their husband ahead of God. And they recognize the way it's tearing apart their relationship. They recognize the state of their family, but they're unwilling to have the difficult conversation. Or even with their kids. They put their kids in the place of God. They replace God with their child's enjoyment or hobbies or pleasure, and they put that above God. Now look, I want to be very careful and very intentional with what I say because I don't want to come across in the wrong way, and I don't want you to hear the wrong thing. I'm in no way saying that if you miss a church service on a Sunday morning because of a family trip, or a sporting event, or whatever it might be, then you've sinned, and well, you might as well just give up and move on because it's over with. But what I am saying is that as parents and as spouses, sometimes we need to take a step back and answer the question, what am I communicating to my family? What am I communicating to my spouse? What am I communicating to my kids, to my extended family, to my friends? What am I communicating with my choices and my practices? Am I allowing the things in my life to dictate my life and my choices? Or am I working to try and use these things that God has blessed me with to bring honor to him? To kind of do like what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. You see, it's not about, or it's about who is going to be calling the shots in our life. Is it going to be my busy schedule that's dictating what I do and my commitment to God? Is it going to be my family members who are going to make the decisions for me and how I do my best to lead my own life and also lead my family? You see, it is so important that we love our families. It is so important that we show that love to our families. And friends, I believe that the greatest gift, the greatest way you can love your family, the greatest way you can love your spouse, the greatest way you can love your kids, the greatest way you can love your friends is to keep Jesus on the throne of your life. Let me say that again. The greatest way you can love these other people in your family is to make sure that Jesus is the one who is at the center of your life. And instead of asking, well, how am I going to fit God into all this? Instead, what we should be doing is starting with God and letting everything else flow out from there. These families, they show us, unfortunately, how to get it wrong. They show us how things should not have worked. And friends, I think unless we intentionally work to build our family on the solid foundation of Jesus, our family is not likely to stand the storms of life that come and beat against those sides. But they also, like I said earlier, they give us hope. They give us hope that God can use each of us. And as many wrecked families we see throughout the pages of scriptures, we know that God can still use every single one of us for his glory and his purposes. And next week, we're going to dive in a little bit more into the homemakers. And it won't be some specific people, but it'll be more about the characteristics that God has called us to, of how we can be people who can build lives and build the kind of families that God wants for all of us. Let me pray for us. Lord, we come to you, and we recognize within ourselves that each and every single one of us, man, we have that tug, that pull towards being a home wrecker. And I don't mean probably in the way that our culture and our society uses that term, but more in the way of missing what you've called us to, of missing the foundation, the model, the characteristics, the purposes that you've called us to. And God, I pray that you would help us to be real with ourselves. Maybe there's some people here right now today that are looking at their own lives. And God, I pray that none of us look at our life and feel like we are worthless or that we can't measure up or that you can't still use us, because you can and you do. But God, I pray that we would be honest with ourselves and that we would see those things in our life. Maybe it is jealousy. Maybe it is pride. Maybe it is idolatry. Whatever it is in our life, God, would you help us to be honest? Would you help us to take a real and honest look at who we are and how our family is operating, maybe even our extended family, maybe even our friendships, and just ask the question, who is in charge here? Lord, would you help us to place you on that throne and not to let anything or anyone move you off that throne of our life as we do our best to be people who follow your model and your pattern? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You guys want to stand up and get singing with us? Here we go.
God, you reign forever and ever.
Singing with us, guys. Y'all have a great Sunday.
Up here, there are some markers and stuff. I really would love for you to come up. We're going to be putting carpet and paint over all this. So don't feel like I can't do that because it's going to be seen. We already have some scriptures. We have a love like Jesus. I really would love for everyone to come up before you leave to grab a Sharpie to at least write something, you know, praying for SCC, a scripture passage, whatever it might come to your mind, for us to really show symbolically how we can build what we do on the Lord. So come and do that today before you leave. Lots of stuff. You only get one, well, maybe 2 weeks. So take advantage of it while you can, because it'll be covered up hopefully very soon. So thank you, folks. Have a great, awesome day.